Let me just very briefly introduce Shobhanaji, because she has much to say and we don't have very much time. But you know, she's on a mission to reintroduce Gandhi to the people of India and everywhere else. Mahatma Gandhi's thought and principles can guide the people as it has the strength to inspire and bring about the change. Imbibing Gandhian values, as she grew up in the ashram in Sevagram in Wardha, her focal point is following the Gandhian way of life and serving humanity. So I will just request her straight up to please, you know, to please make her presentation and a talk, and which we'll follow up with the question and answer. But I want to give her sufficient time, so I wouldn't want to stand between you and Shobhanaji.
My first obeisance is to God Almighty, who has inspired me to take up this task. My second obeisance is to the Mahatma, the great soul, the enlightened one, the compassionate one, whose life can inspire us all, can enlighten us all from inside out. His faith and endeavor make him a role model for all of us at all ages, in all times. And my third obeisance is to the Lokatma, to all of you whose eyes give me strength. I also pay my respects to the Bodhisattva Padampani, the awakened being or the enlightened being of Mahayana Buddhism, who vows to come back again and again as long as there are living beings in order to help all living beings. That's what Gandhi said also, that he is not going to be silent from his grave. He's going to speak from his grave, and he's going to speak again and again, reminding people that peace is a positive force, that compassion is in all of us. We only have to put it into practice in the form of serving others. It's a great honor for me to be today to deliver the 28th Padampani lecture organized by the Tibet House. And I'm missing Geshe, Venerable Geshe La today. It is on his request that I am here, and I express my deepest gratitude to Venerable Geshe Dorji Damdul, Director of the Tibet Center, to IIC for co-hosting this program, and to all of you who have gathered here on this very, very auspicious day. Today, the epitome of compassion, Jesus Christ, was born. Today also happens to be the birthday of my daughter. Since I had committed to be here, I'm here with you all, sharing my joy. And for this opportunity which all of you have given me, and for your time that you have given me, the most valuable resource that all of us have, our time, to be here with me today, to discuss an issue which haunts and taunts people across the world. Mahatma Gandhi is the most powerful visionary and a practical idealist from the last half of the 21st century, who is a role model for all of us. He was there about 67 years ago with us. It's not as if I'm talking about a long past. He, like all of us, was an ordinary human being, just like all of us. Mahatma Gandhi sought to break the cycle of violence and reprisal. What distinguishes us from brute beasts, he said, is our continuous striving for moral self-improvement. Humanity is at crossroads, and we must choose between violence, the law of the jungle, and non-violence, the law of humanity. The world today, I'm very happy to see some young friends who have also come, and I really, really welcome you all. It's really something which makes me very happy to welcome you all today, young people. Thank you for coming. You all have an unprecedented opportunity to open a new phase in the history of humankind. Mahatma Gandhi's life offers us a compelling evidence that we can become the conscious shapers of our destiny, rather than merely being shaped by circumstances. Mahatma Gandhi had unflinching faith in nonviolence. And in Gandhiji's personality, the politician and saint emerged as one. 66 years or 67 years after his death, history appears to prove that it would have been much wiser not to have abandoned his method, which was an inseparable method of politics and spirituality. I would like to share something which His Holiness the Dalai Lama has said about Gandhiji in a very short clipping.
So, in 20th century, wonderful Indian, Mahatma Gandhiji, just tiny follower of Mahatma Gandhiji's example.
I would like to share with you a story about how compassionate he was. And since we heard about his days in South Africa, he, like all of you sitting here, was a highly educated person. He was a barrister. He had gone educated in London. He had gone to South Africa for 1 year to help in a case. And I'm sure you all must have read his autobiography. Does anybody know the name of the autobiography? My Experiments with Truth. And whatever I'm saying, I have read from there also. So I'm not saying anything new. So when he went there and came face to face with racial discrimination and the situation of Indians, he decided to stay on, and he stayed on for 21 years in South Africa. He went at the age of 24, and how many of you are of 24 years here? Anybody who is 20, you are 24. So at your age, he had gone. And he wanted to practice. He wanted to be a successful barrister like all of you. Everybody has a dream. But there, he decided that he has to stay back, because the injustice, the racial discrimination that Indians and Asians, and that includes people from Malaya and China also, anybody with a brown or yellow or black skin were being faced with this kind of discrimination. He said the root of this cause is very, very deep. In order to thrash it, to take it out, he'll have to really struggle very hard and offer great sacrifice. So he decided to stay back. So I'm going to tell you a story about what happened in 1906. He had, of course, decided to change his life overnight when on a train ride from Johannesburg to Durban, he was given a book called by Ruskin, John Ruskin, called Unto This Last. And overnight he changed his life to a community living, simple life based on labor. So this is Durban, where he used to live. This is the Phoenix settlement. So you see the house, and in front of the house, I'm talking about something which happened 100 years ago. Okay, so go back in flashback now. So there was this very huge tree. And Gandhi was sitting outside, and there was one person who was peeping at him all the time, trying to make some eye contact. And whenever Gandhiji looked at him, he would turn away, he would hide behind the tree. So ultimately Gandhiji went there and he said, what is it that you want to tell me? What are you trying to say? He said, I have come here, I have heard that you help all kinds of people. I have come here asking for help. So he was a Zulu tribesman, black skin, and he said he was suffering from leprosy, a disease which was considered incurable, and the patients were outcast from the society and nobody would touch them. So Gandhi called him inside that house, cleaned his wounds with warm water and potassium permanganate, bandaged it, and he had a good mind to take care of him at home. But all these, can I go back to the slide? He had all these ashramites, community members, who were living with him, and he thought maybe they would object. Therefore, he contacted his friend or a senior called Parsi Rustamji, who was also from India, Surat, and he was a very well-known businessman there, and asked him to find a shelter for such people. So he was taken and kept in a place, and then of course Parsi Rustamji was inspired by Gandhiji to build a hospital for leprosy patients. And there is a story about Parsi Rustamji also, and how Gandhiji's Sangat changed his life is also there, but I'm not going into that. But what started as compassion and service to people, spread as social service and service to humanity in Gandhiji's life. So how being very compassionate gets translated into action is very important. Just feeling compassion inside our heart is not enough. Translating it to help others, to really doing things for others to alleviate their suffering is most important. And it continued in Gandhiji's life, so much so that in 1940, in Sevagram ashram where I was born, this is the last ashram that Gandhiji had established in 1936. And this is the Gandhi Kuti. So he was sitting inside and somebody came and said that there's a man who is looking like a beggar, he's waiting outside the gate and he only wants to meet Gandhiji. He only wants to talk to Gandhiji. So Gandhiji went rushing there and he saw this person absolutely in tatters and very, very worn out, and Gandhiji immediately recognized him. He said, oh, you are Parchure Shastri. Shastriji, what are you doing here? Because Shastriji used to be the Sanskrit teacher in Sabarmati ashram, the earlier ashram in Gujarat, and he had gone home. So Parchure Shastriji, first thing he did was to do a sashtang and namaskar to Gandhiji, and he said, I have come here with two desires, two wishes. I want to live in the ashram and I want to die in the ashram. Gandhiji said, you have two desires, two wishes, I can only fulfill one. That is, you can live in the ashram, but I will not let you die in the ashram. So he brought him to the ashram, made a small kuti in front of the Bapu kuti, a cottage. Kuti is a cottage. And every day for 45 minutes, he used to personally massage him, got the doctors to examine him, and he started his treatment. This is in 1940, inspired by Gandhiji. Many, many people got into serving leprosy patients, and even in India, even today, we tend to somehow distance ourselves with such people. But at that time, people who started this work are continuing to this day. That is the testimony to how Gandhi could change people, give them direction in life, to do, show them the purpose in life as to what they could do to serve others. So, this is of course the Prarthana Bhumi. I'll talk about Sevagram Ashram a little later. But at this point, I wanted to just tell you how the compassion, daya, karuna that Gandhi had, and he is not the only person, all of us have it. Each one of us has that kind of feeling inside us. All of us have that inner power. It's just up to us to awaken that, to identify that, and just put it into practice of serving others. According to my understanding, Gandhiji's life is an epic of faith and endeavor. The source of his real strength was in his faith in God. The deeper the faith, the greater was the endeavor. Truth was the most deepest and most complete form of God for him. He called truth as God. Satya hi Parameshwar hai, he said. So his endeavor was to identify that truth, to nurture it, and to inspire people to recognize that truth in themselves. And he believed that in each one of us, as God is omnipresent, truth is omnipresent too. That is, in each one of us, there is an element of goodness present. All of us have that. We are born with it. We are very, very lucky, because the same power that there is in the universe resides in us also. And therefore, that Gandhiji's endeavor throughout his life was to awaken, nurture, and inspire the power to come out and help others. The other belief that he had, that in spite of all the ups and downs in the history of humanity, humankind will always move towards an auspicious direction, because God, truth, that is God, is only interested in the welfare of its creation. These were the two beliefs he had in his quest for truth. Now in this century, we are confronting many, many challenges, not less than what Gandhi confronted in the 20th century. Today we have so much advancement, industrial, economic, information revolution, technology revolutions, and we are all connected through all these revolutions, but we are at the same time witnessing financial and economic collapse of regions which owed the most to this capitalist development, even as amazing transformations are taking place every day, in many cases for the good of us, and in many cases respect for the worse. So, talking about Gandhiji's ideology, I would like to tell you that truth, non-violence, and purity of means, because I have to really make this entire thing very short and bring whatever I want to tell you very quickly. So, truth, nonviolence, and purity of means were his three ideologies. And I can expand on it maybe some other time, or maybe you would like to read up on it, or maybe you would like me to come and let you understand a little bit. But I just want to let you know that he was an ordinary person like you and me, just like us. And that ordinary person, how he could transform himself to this extraordinary person that he became, is what I'm more interested in. Because that's what matters to us. We want to know how he did it and whether we can do it too, whether we have the capacity to do that. So we'll be examining a little bit of that. Also, I want to talk about very briefly about his three gifts to humanity, which is Satyagraha, Constructive Program, and Ekadashavrata. I don't know how many of you have heard about, Satyagraha? Yeah. So a couple of hands are going up. How about Constructive Program? So just one. And how about Ekadashavrata? Nobody knows. This Ekadashavrata, I would like to touch upon Ekadashavrata because very, very few people know what Gandhi meant by Ekadashavrata. Whereas the world over, we know very well about Satyagraha. Constructive Program is how he translated his full social service into establishing the self-respect and justice for the common people. That is also called social service, and that can be named by anything now. Constructive action, constructive programs is what you do to really change the lives of people, which all of us are capable of changing the lives of people by helping them to make their condition better. But I would like to focus today on Ekadashavrata. These Ekadasha, does anybody know what Ekadasha means? Any of it?
11.
And Vrata?
Fasting.
Sanskrit is a language which is so beautiful. Vrata means fasting also. Vrata means rules also. So Gandhiji, whereas he was just an ordinary person transforming himself, and he was in the quest for truth, he was also equally concerned about the inner sadhana. And without that sadhana, one is not in tune with the inner self, with the bodhicitta, with yourself, with that compassionate self that you are, with that beautiful manifestation of that supreme energy that all of us are. So to become that and to understand the reality of the reality of being or shunyata, it is very important to understand what it is all about. So I would like to talk about a little bit about Ekadashavrata. So the principle is already there. Do unto others what you do unto yourself. Very simple. जैसा अपने लिए चाहते हो वैसा ही दूसरों के साथ करो. Not very difficult. We have all grown up hearing that. Our grandparents, our parents have always said that through stories, through our great epics and Puranas. This is the message. Very simple. So Gandhiji, while he was growing up, he had seen his mother Putli Bai undergo very strict vratas, that is fasting. Jo abhi, just now somebody said fasting. She was very much a devout Hindu, fasting in Choma on many occasions, but she was doing it for herself. Gandhi was not interested in vrata for himself. He wanted this to be established as societal norms. Any vow that, and these vows give inner strength to whoever observes these vratas, and these are also called observances. So Gandhiji put a set of 11 observances in his ashram. He said, these are the things that I I'm doing personally, and I want everybody who has joined me to do this. And what was that? His disciple Vinoba Bhaveji put it into a kind of a verse, and we used to sing it in the morning and evening prarthana in the ashram. It is called Ahimsa Satyam Asteya Brahmacharya Asangraha Sharira Shrama Aswada Sarvatra Bhayavarjana Sarva Dharma Samanatva Swadeshi Sparsha Bhavana Vinamra Vrata Nishthase Ye Ekadasha Sevyahe. Now, these are very, very solid words. Ahimsa Satya Asteya Brahmacharya Nasangraha, that is non-violence, truth, non-stealing, Brahmacharya and non-possession. These are the Pancha Mahavratas in the Vedas, described in the Vedas as Pancha Mahavratas. It is there in all the religions in the world. And Gandhiji said, ultimately, all the religions point to the same truth. Therefore, we must all study the essence of all the religions and must have an attitude of reverence and friendship towards the practitioners of other religions. So all these five are the Panchamahavratas acceptable by all the religions in the world. Jainas call it Pancha. I forget the name right now. I'll come back to it. To that, Gandhi added Sharira Shrama. This was something Gandhi added from bread labor, from Tolstoy's bread labor, that you must work for your sustenance. You must do Shrama, Sharira Shrama, for your sustenance. Aswada is control of the palate. Now the palate is very, very difficult to control. But once you have the control over palates, you can really bring out your hidden energies. And this is not only about the palate, it is about how you speak, how you use the speech. That is the beautiful gift that God has given us. Vak, how vani is used, how your tongue is used. Sarvatra Bhayavarjana, when Gandhi came here, he saw that Indians were literally very, very afraid. In 1915, when he came back here, first thing he noticed that we were all very, very scared. We were slaves. And the first lesson that he taught in Bihar, in Champaran, was to become fearless. And even in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna talks, in the 16th chapter, Krishna talks about fearlessness as one of the attributes to be cultivated. These are divine attributes that all of us have. And fearlessness hits it. And the last one is vinamrata, humility. In between, there are many 14 divine attributes. And that is what he taught us, to become fearless. Fearlessness is one of the lessons that Gandhi taught to all of us, and that is something which we learned very quickly. And you saw in the film how everybody flocked, left their homes, left their jobs, left everything and followed, gave their everything for freedom. Then Sarva Dharma Samanatva, that is equality of religions that I was pointing out to you right now. And in our ashram prayers, all the prayers were Sarva Dharma prayers. Morning and evening prayers used to be conducted at 4 a.m. and 5 p.m. Something which started as community meeting in Phoenix settlement culminated into Sarva Dharma Prarthana morning and evening. And it was one of the community activities. As I pointed out, Gandhiji said that ultimately all the religions point out to the same truth. And that's what we all observed in the ashram. Swadeshi. About Swadeshi, you all know a lot. Sparsha Bhavana is about untouchability. So these are the 11 vows that every ashramite had to take and had to practice it in the ashram to bring out their inner hidden power. And this is something which I really want people to know, because none of us really know about this Ekadasha Vrata as a gift from Gandhiji to humanity. You can follow any one of that and see whether your inner strength begins to manifest or not. Because ultimately, as you all said, the title of Gandhiji's autobiography is My Experiments with Truth. So each one of us has to experiment with our own truth, which with whatever we think is true and right, we need to experiment and find out. You all find out, you're all, this is all there. Find out, practice it on yourself. So these are the three gifts that I was talking about. And this contained the essence of Gandhiji's vision in life. So when you read up and try to understand Gandhi and to put your heart into really absorbing what he was saying, remember these things. I'm very happy to inform you that I was born in Gandhiji's Sevagram ashram. Now the Sevagram ashram is in Wardha. Is anybody here from Maharashtra? Anybody? You are there from Maharashtra. Are you from Nagpur? Kolhapur? Okay. So you know Nagpur. About 85 kilometers from Nagpur is a place called Wardha. Many of the southbound trains pass through Wardha. And about 5 miles from Wardha was the place where Gandhiji set up his ashram. And the name of that village was Segaon. And that was given to him by Jamnalal Bajaji. He had an orange orchard. And Gandhiji and Mirabhen and all of them settled there. And with whatever available material was there, he constructed his kuti. Everybody had small, small places to live. And Mirabhen really beautifully made that Gandhi kuti. And I was born there. Not in the kuti, but in Sevagram. After Gandhiji passed away, for the next 60 odd years, my father continued following the path shown by Gandhiji, and continued doing Gandhi Karya, which even I continue doing. And that Karya is for each one of us to do. He's the father of our nation. He has shown what is to be done. And it's up to us to do it. It's our time now. He did when he could. It is our time to do it now. So I was talking about the Prarthana. Community prayer used to be conducted in this Prarthana Bhumi. And I went a couple of years ago to give a lecture in Nagpur. So I'm sitting there, and spinning I learned at the age of 5. All of us had to do this. There were 4 community activities. One was community prayer. The other was community spinning. The third was community eating. And the fourth was community sanitation. And that is something very, very interesting and important. Every morning, Gandhiji and the smallest of the kids used to carry the basket and the jhadu and the powder and clean up the entire ashram. This was a daily community activity. And if we all do that Swachh Bharat will take slowly, slowly take shape. But none of us are interested in any community cleaning or cleaning at all. And Gandhiji, first thing that he used to do was to clean the toilets. Even in South Africa, from there he had come to India to understand about the Congress, Indian National Congress, because he had established Natal Indian Congress there. So he wanted to know how it functions. When he came here, it was a big function, lot of talks, lot of lectures going on, a lot of crowd. But when he saw the condition of the toilets, it was pathetic. It's very, very bad. So the first thing that compassionate Gandhi starts doing was to take the broom and sweep the toilets. He started cleaning the toilets. And so much so that the secretary of that Indian National Congress pointed out to people that this is how volunteers should be, not realizing that it was Gandhi who was cleaning the toilets. So the first training that we all got was of cleaning the toilets. But it was such an enjoyable experience. It was a wonderful training. And I must beseech all of you today to at least start cleaning your toilets. Learn that. That is the first thing one needs to do. And when one very young economist, Sriman Narayanji, he came from London School of Economics and wanted to tell Gandhiji many things because he thought that he had some very brilliant ideas and that had to be translated into Indian context, and Gandhiji is the best person to do that. So when he came, well, of course, it was morning time, and Gandhiji said, yes, we will talk later, but now is the time for community work, safai. So he was told to go and clean the toilet, and he was really shocked. That young 24-year-old brilliant economist, he was shattered, totally shattered. What is this? How could one do this? But his life changed after that. He became a big, proper disciple of Gandhiji. And such people, whoever came in contact with Gandhiji, became like this. So I want doing. And what are we doing in India? Where are we? What reality are we talking about? What are we doing? And this is what my mission is, to make people understand about Gandhiji. Just understand what kind of a person he was, how he transformed himself. What are the leadership traits that he had? What are those qualities that we see in Gandhiji? But before that, as I said, his entire quest was the search for truth. And he defined truth as to utter as you think and to act as you utter. Jaisa socho, vaisa bolo, vaisa hi karo. Now, can there be a simple definition of truth than this? Utter as you think and act as you utter. Simple. Try it. Jaisa socho, vaisa bolo, aur vaisa hi karo. And that is satya in Gandhiji's definition. So I just wanted to let you know that this is very simple thing which you can try in your life and see whether it works. And this, that means there was this unity of mind, speech, harmony of mind, speech and deeds. The moment there is unity of mind, speech and deed, you come out as a very transparent person. And that's what is required in each sphere of life. Transparency. Because it is so simple, people find it very difficult to do it, you see. So that is I think Gandhi pinches them. Because it's very simple yet very difficult to do. But then one can do it, because if Gandhi could do it, we can do it too. The simple definition of truth bears testimony to his transparencies. Transparency. Now, I would like also, what are we going to do now? We are going to talk about, wait, I would like to talk about how, maybe now while I'm talking, maybe you're liking something, and maybe you are thinking that, acha, we can also experiment like this, and we can also change ourselves slightly. And I want to tell you how people world over got inspired at change and changed themselves. So I want to tell you a couple of examples of how Gandhi lives on. So one of the first persons who immediately understood Gandhi in his struggle for civil rights was Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And we have an audio, I think. Do we have it? Can we play that? So I can take a break.
Person who has influenced my life in terms of action more than anybody is Mahatma Gandhi.
Gandhi? Well, where did you come to Gandhi?
I came to Gandhi in the same setting, in theological seminary days. I had heard of Gandhi, but I remembered hearing a message by the president of Howard University, Dr. Mordecai Johnson, who had just returned from India. In Philadelphia on his trip to India and the whole philosophy of Gandhi and passive or nonviolent resistance. I was so deeply moved by the message that I went away and bought several books on the Gandhian, on Gandhi and Gandhian technique. And at that point, I became deeply influenced by never realizing that I would live in a situation where it would be useful in me.
And actually used it in, actually would apply it in
this
country.
The second person, of course, who was very much inspired by Mahatma Gandhi was Nelson Mandela. In India, when he was here, he said, the India sent us Barrister Mohandas Gandhi. We returned Mahatma Gandhi to you, to India. And that's how he spoke about Gandhiji and got inspired. Then Albert Einstein. Do we have an audio of Albert Einstein? So see what he's saying.
I believe that Gandhi's views were the most enlightened of all the political men in our time. We should strive to do things in his spirit, not to use violence in fighting for our cause, but by non-participation in anything you believe is evil.
He also had said a very important thing about Gandhi, that generations to come will scarce believe that such a one like this, in flesh and blood, ever walked on this earth. So while we will all pass on, thousands of years from now, I don't know whether Gandhiji will be treated as a human being or a deity, because I want to establish that he was a very ordinary person like us. He was just like us. Therefore, if he could do it, even we are capable of invoking, of inspiring ourselves to bring out the goodness that we have. Gurudev also wrote a very beautiful song for Gandhiji when he was breaking his fast in Aga Khan temple, and I would like to play that song for you. Gandhiji and Gurudev had great regard for each other. And he had come when Gandhiji was about to break his fast, and he had written this beautiful poem for Gandhiji. And then we will see.
What was the meaning of this?
Didi, Jayadi, can you explain the meaning of this? Jibono Jokhon Shukai, therefore. Anybody Bengali, please.
I don't understand.
Okay. Anybody who understands Bangla, or Google it. So right now we will go to Google, Swami. Not now, when you go back. But I understand the meaning of it very beautifully, which I'm unable to right now explain to you. Please read up. Then we come to somebody, Vinoba Bhaveji. We had a very good fortune of working with Vinobaji, and he went on this Padayatra for Bhudan, for distribution of land for the landless, from 1952. For 30 years, he roamed all across India to get land for the landless poor. And he was also one of the first, one of the persons where the dacoits of Jora and Chambal surrendered their arms. So this is Gandhiji's disciple, and in Gandhiji's own language, the first Satyagrahi. This is where I was also present at this time when Man Singh and all those people, the dacoits of Chambal, had surrendered. And these are the stalwarts that we have to think and remember, and how much inner power all of us have to do that. So if they could do it, we can also do some good deeds. And this is about the Chipko Andolan, which Sundarlal Bahugunaji did in Uttarakhand, where timber mafia was chopping the trees. Women encircled the trees and did not let people cut it, and it was spearheaded by Sundarlalji, who is a very, very dear colleague of my father's. And inspired by this, Japanese women also started hugging the trees, and they did not let people destroy it. So these are very small, simple examples from world over. And now here there is Father Kunz from Brazil, from Sao Paulo. Now Father Kunz used to, he didn't live in the posh area in Sao Paulo in Brazil, but he used to live in a hillock, which was an area where only very poor people lived, and there were slums there. So Father Kunz lived amongst the poorest of the poor, serving them. Once there was very, very severe drought, famine in Brazil. And people started moving towards Sao Paulo because the grains were there. Every rich community was living there, so poor people started going there for want of food. But suddenly in the newspaper, in the editorial, people said, we should be given license for guns. We want to kill all these people. They are coming and looting our grains. How can they do this? We want to kill them. Father Kunz was very hurt on hearing this sentiment. So he went to the church, which was in the middle of the city. And he asked permission to pray there. And he was a Christian father. Church said, most welcome, Father. You are here for praying. You're most welcome. But he said, I'm not here only for praying. I'm here to offer fast for 21 days for this callousness of human, of my fellow beings. I feel very pained that they are talking about acquiring guns to kill hungry people. And I want to fast. So the rich people of Sao Paulo started laughing at Father Kunz. They said, oh, here is another man, another hungry person who will die in 4 days. So they all laughed at him, but Father Kunz kept on fasting. On the fourth day, people started feeling very uneasy. They came to Father. They said, Father, can we also fast with you? Father said, no. You can do that for one day. But for the rest of the days, you all just pray. The very next day, end of the fast of 21 days, in each of the houses, there was this notice that everybody is welcome to eat with them. This is the kind of strength that Gandhi inspired. And Father Kunz was very much inspired by Gandhi. Here is the power of nonviolence of the Innus tribe from North Pole. And their only sustenance is through fishing. But many years ago, NATO fighter planes were flying very low to their area. And that noise pollution killed fish. And they were going hungry. So all these people, they were helpless. What did they do? They formed a human chain and prevented the planes from landing there. And that made them understand to stop taking the planes there. So these are the simple practices that people all over the world, without having met Gandhi, but without even having any training in nonviolence, just did it. This is the kind of impact that Gandhi had. This, of course, all of us know, and now in the era of deep ecological crisis, what Gandhi had warned us about 100 years ago, this was not today that he's saying. He said it 100 years ago, that earth provides enough for man's need, to satisfy every man's need, but not every man's greed. But look what we have gotten ourselves into. What answers are we going to give to the next generation? What answers are we going to give to people, billions of people who are standing behind us, who are invisible to us, the poor? We don't see them. They're there, but we don't see them. These are the invisible people. And once in Sevagram ashram, one Christian priest had come. His name is Dr. Mort. He had come for a conference in Madras. But he traveled all the way, taking all this trouble to meet Gandhiji, because he wanted to ask him 3 questions. One of the questions was, in your opinion, Mr. Gandhi, what is the biggest challenge that India faces at this time? So he welcome. So he must have thought that it is, Gandhi will say that it is poverty, or the fact that we are slaves. Gandhi may say this, Dr. Mote thought. And at that time, Gandhi was very pressed for time, as you had said something about Ravindra Varmaji. And he had asked for all those questions and he wanted to give them a written answer. But here, for some reason, Gandhi said that you are asking me what is the biggest problem that my country faces? It is the callousness of middle class intellectuals. It is the callous attitude of the middle class. That's what bothers me. We have a whole lot of problems there, whole generation which is coming here, whole lot of people, invisible people who are standing there. But we are only interested in what we are going to get out of it. Hamare liye kya hai? That is what it is all about. Till you do not get out of the selfishness that all of us have, we do not get out of that selfish attitude, we really cannot be compassionate, we cannot serve humanity. So this is something which I want to end my little Gandhi Lives On presentation with clipping of prisoners in Cebu Island in Philippines. They have a weekly routine of coming out and dancing and see what they do. Okay. I hope you like this dance. And there are countless such examples and there are countless such people who have been inspired by Gandhiji all over the world and in India and everywhere. So now, this, okay, want to show this? This year on the occasion of the International Day of Nonviolence, I had the privilege of unveiling the statue of Mahatma Gandhi in Tunisia. I was there. And the lecture was held in Manoba University for students who were very eager to understand about nonviolence. They're very, very scared of all the violence that is going on. So they were particularly interested in Gandhian ideology of nonviolence, peace, and truth. So anyway, so I was there, and I don't know how that slide came up. So one of my missions is to travel everywhere to talk about Gandhiji. And so now I would like to, now we are 7:15,
yes,
and I want to still go on. So I want to touch a little bit about Gandhiji's qualities. Okay, so the first quality that I would like to talk about is he used to call himself a practical idealist. All of us are idealists, but he called himself practical idealist because whatever he read, saw, believed, or heard, if he liked it, he started immediately practicing that. Now that is what the crux of it is all about. We are all reading a lot, maybe about whatever you are reading right now, whatever inspires you. We have the examples of all the big, big Mahapurush. Today it's such a fortunate day because we have, this is the Christmas Eve. And Jesus Christ, the epitome of compassion, that's whom we remember. Mahatma Buddha, we are sitting in the benign shadow, in the presence of Buddha, of Avalokiteshvara, of Bodhisattva Padmapani, and such great people, Guru Nanak, Kabir, and you can name anybody who had walked on the pure path to show us enlightenment. Gandhi was inspired with everybody of them. He had the example of everybody. But what he had also was his inner power, inner voice. And he could touch base with that inner voice or power through introspection, through questioning, and through being firm on truth. So we have already defined what he said by truth, to utter as one thinks and to act as one utters. And also we see that he was constantly experimenting with himself. And therefore, he had an ever-growing personality. He never stopped becoming a student. Till the last day, he remained a student. On 30th of January 1948, in the morning, he was learning to read and write Bangla. Because why? Because while India was celebrating freedom, Gandhi was not there in Delhi. He was in Noakhali, in West Bengal, and even now West Bengal is facing a big crisis of riots. And I really feel very, very sad about it. That's all I'm doing. But Gandhi went there to Noakhali, and he went alone while the nation was celebrating freedom. This one man who dreamt of freedom, who really, really worked for the freedom of India, was not in Delhi. He was in Noakhali. And at this time, I want to show you a live footage of Noakhali, just to take you back of how this 79-year-old young person was there.
Tireless in his pursuit of communal harmony, the pilgrim progressed, making his way through the inaccessible delta of the Ganga.
Light, please. Can you switch off the light? Please, excuse me.
If they answer not thy call, walk alone. If they do not hold up the light when the night is troubled with storm, with the thunder flame of pain, ignite thine own heart and let it burn alone.
Jolly,
akla cholo, walk alone. If nobody comes along with you in your quest for spirituality, if your quest in your quest for serving humanity, don't worry, walk alone, do it, do what you can, because this life is too short, time is too limited. The only non-renewable resource that we all have is time. If we are lucky, we'll be alive the next moment. If we are not, we have to leave. We all come in this earth with one purpose, that is to serve others with compassion. And this is a call to everybody to arise and awake, and wake up and understand the call that our, in our limited life, we have to fulfill the purpose of our life. Uttishtata jagrata prapta varan nibodhat kshurasya dhara nishita duratya. It's a very sharp edge that we have to walk on this earth. We are not here to waste our life. We are here to serve others. That is our swadharma. That is our duty, obligatory duty. When we are born, we take so much from our parents. We take so much from the neighbors. We take so much from society. It is our obligation to return all that to our people, to our society, to our nation, to our parents. Therefore, to each and every young person, old, everybody, I remind people of their swadharma, their obligatory duties. Krishna talks about swadharma in the Bhagavad Gita. And all these things have been talked about from the time of the Vedas, Upanishads, from the time of Buddha to the time he said, Atma Deepo Bhava. You become your own light. You have that capacity to become enlightened. So it is a call for to everybody to just get up, awake, get up, arise and awake and be vigilant. You can't even lose one moment in just sleeping. And in Gandhiji's life, one of the qualities that I want to mention is that he used to be ever vigilant. Forever he was vigilant and awake. And from that awakened state, and that's what Padmapani Bodhisattva is also called, the awakened self. How do they get awakened? Because they realize the reality of life. They know that all of us are interconnected with each other. We are manifestations of the same supreme power energy. And therefore Gandhiji could feel that oneness with everybody. And the moment that truth is realized that we are interconnected, we are part of each other, we are one family, and we are here only for the purpose of serving others. That realization, or shunyata as it is called, the moment that realization comes, you really find that wisdom. And once you become wisdom, what you get automatically is that your intellect gets sharpened. We are born with two things, mind and intellect. Once we start thinking with the mind, we think with emotions. We make wrong decisions because something we like, something we dislike. And whatever we decide, it gets colored by emotions. But when the intellect is sharpened, when the enlightenment is there, when awareness is there, when the knowledge is very firm, what we get is a very sharp intellect. And we develop the qualities which are very nice of discipline, promptness, and third one, time up. Promptness, discipline, and punctuality. So for me, it was a reminder to be punctual. And my time was till 7:30. And in Gandhiji's life, I must tell you, punctuality played a very great life. A great role. He always used to carry the clock here in his waist. And time was of very, very great importance. So I must quickly tell you a story about this. And that is in Sevagram ashram. And he used to sit in that kuti. He used to sit down. And people used to come to meet him. Hundreds of people used to come to meet him every day. And there was very little time, as you said, even those 2 minutes were important. So somebody from the ashram management must have thought of putting a board there so that people could understand the value of time, Gandhiji's time at least, because generally people do not understand the value of their own time. So they waste a lot of time, in procrastinating and just wasting time talking and doing just nothing, simply talking. So here, somebody from the ashram management wanted to do that. So they put a board with three sentences in English, with two words each, so that the person who would come and sit in front of Gandhiji could see, because can I show them that slide or is it not possible? Okay, anyway, even if the slide is not there, you visualize now that at the back of Gandhiji's bag, there was at that time, there was one board. So the first sentence said, be quick. Jaldi karo. I don't know in which language it can be translated because there's so many people from different regions and languages, but jaldi karo, everybody understands, be quick. The second verse, namaskar. The second one said, be brief, which I am not. Sankshep mein kaho. Sankshep mein kaho. And the third one was a bit dangerous. It said, be gone. Chalte bano. And that's where it was. Now it's not there. Maybe it was removed later. I don't know. But I'm just saying, the person who used to sit in front of Gandhiji could read that. And of course, they would be given only 2 minutes. So they would go. But before that, they could see all this. So my father, who was an adolescent at that time, was very not happy about it. Because adolescents generally are very critical. They question a lot. They don't like many things. So I hope once they grow up, they start understanding. And I hope all of us sitting here have crossed that adolescent age. No? So better to cross it now. And so my father, who was about 16, 17 years old, he said, I must find out, because this is wrong, this is not right. How could Gandhi, who is from Saurashtra, how could he tell all this to people? The Saurashtra is known for its mehman nawazi, atithi satkar. Even our Indians are known for so much atithi satkar. We, whenever somebody comes, we tell them to make themselves comfortable. We give them some water. Later on, we offer them some tea. Later on, something. And a lot of time goes away. And later on only, we say, bhai kahiye kaise aana hua hai. But here, there is no such formality. Here, there is be brief, be quick, and be gone. What is all this? My father said, oh, I must do some tahkikat, because investigative journalism was very much in evidence at that time also. So he followed a person who had gone inside the kuti and came out in 2 minutes. So my father asked him, excuse me, sir, did you meet Gandhi? That man's face lit up like a 1,000-watt bulb had gone on. He was so happy. He said, yes, of course, I met Gandhi. Ji, I met Papu. My father said, what kind of a meeting is this? You just went inside and came out in 2 minutes. You didn't even spend 2 minutes there. What kind of a meeting is this? He said, you are right. I spent just 2 minutes. But in those 2 minutes, Gandhiji poured himself in my heart. He entered my heart. And that was the quality of Gandhi, to become one with the other person, to respect individuals as individuals without attaching any labels. He didn't attach any labels, whether you were rich or poor, whether you were learned or an uneducated man, whether you were a king or a farmer, whether you were a politician or an ordinary person like us. No, there was no label. He respected each and every person as a person. And the moment we start doing that, we start applying it, giving that respect to others as human beings, as individuals, we would have started walking on Gandhi path, Gandhi marg. So therefore, it is 7:30, my time is up. And I am very, very grateful for all of you once again for giving your non-renewable resource to me, your time, for being here with me. And I'm very grateful to Tibet House for giving me this opportunity of talking about compassion, talking about enlightenment, talking about how an ordinary person like you and me can also do things to change the world. Gandhiji had said, be the change that you want to see in the world. Thank you so much. Namaskar.